give the name above all names, the one who reigns forever, still the same. Praise the name. No other name that's higher, no other name that's stronger, no other name. Forever I will praise the name. No other name that can heal us, no other name that can free us, no other name.
Too precious.
Let's praise the name.
Here we go.
Praise the name above all names, the one who reigns forever, still the same. Praise the name, Jesus, Jesus, name above all names, the one who reigns forever, still the same. Stronger, no other name. Forever I will praise the name. No other name that can heal us. No other name that can free us. No other name too precious.
Let's
praise the name.
There is no other name I know. Jesus. Every nation.
Every nation. Oh, creation. People.
Amen. It is so good to be together today. Happy New Year. Welcome to 2021 as we celebrate God's presence and love and new beginnings. And so welcome to worship on this Lord's Day. If you're here in the fellowship hall, welcome. If you're at home in your living room, your bedroom, wherever you may be, we are so glad that you are here present with us today. So we encourage you to especially if you're at home, to create a worshipful space before you. Have your Bible ready. If you have a journal, please, if you have your Better Tomorrow journal or Our Journey journal or just a regular old journal, and light a candle and allow Christ's light and love to permeate the space in which you are worshiping. Today, we're going to be in Psalm 84, so get your Bibles ready and turn to Psalm 84, and that's where I'm going to read our call to worship this morning. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord God Almighty. Your soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Let us worship our God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah, holy, holy, high you. Amen.
Good morning, good morning. We're happy you're here and happy new year. If you would take a minute to connect with us in the new year and give us your information on your connection card. If you're here, you can put your tithes and your offerings right in the envelope. If you're at home, look right above where I'm speaking. You can fill out your connection card. And if you have a new email address or anything else like that, update it so we can keep in touch with you in the new year. If you look at your connection card at the bottom, your tithes and your offerings can be submitted right there. And if you want a text to give, you can do the 530-LOVE, 5463. You just text the amount that you'd like to give, the word give, and it'll come right to us. It'll prompt you through if you've never done it before. But thank you.
Thanks, Rebecca. It is so good to be together and be in the presence of the Lord. My name is Valina Hoy. I'm one of the pastors here, and we're just so glad to be in the presence of the Lord this morning. Joel Phillips, who is our virtual pastoral intern, will be preaching today while Jim Wood is away, so we're glad to have him sharing the word with us today. I have just a few other announcements I want to share with you. Great things happening in 2021 at First Presbyterian. So this week is just the best week for our master classes. So please tune in. We have one tomorrow that's just going to set our hearts in the right direction. Joel Phillips is going to be teaching a class on Monday. All these classes are at 7 p.m. on Zoom, so you can find the link on our website. So Monday is How to Read the Bible with Joel Phillips. So just a wonderful way to start the new year. And then Wednesday, we're going to be talking about setting goals for the new year, and Mark Fulton, who is a professional leadership coach, will be teaching that particular master class, so tune in. And then on Thursday, George Pratt is going to be talking about, Dr. George Pratt, who is a counseling psychologist, is going to be talking about breaking old habits. So wonderful way to be in the Bible, to set some goals and break old habits, all in the first full week in January. Awesome. So please tune in. Also, our women's Bible study classes are starting back up this week as well. Christine Rand is going to be teaching on the book of Ezekiel. So exciting stuff. So please be a part of that, women, Wednesday morning on Zoom at 9:30, and then Thursday evening at 7 on Zoom as well. So let us know on the connection card if you'd like to be a part of that. We'll be sure that you get the proper links for that. And then also mark your calendars. It's just days away. Our Lead Like King event. It's going to be fantastic. It's virtual. It's going to be hosted by the Urban Renewal Center and also Jake's Divinity School. It's going to be great. So register online. It's $25 a person, and it's just going to be an amazing, amazing event. 7 Central Time, 8 Eastern Time. Just wow. It's going to be great. So let's continue to invest our time into ways that will continue to extend and proclaim the kingdom of God.
Good morning, church. So hopefully you have your Bibles and you have them marked for Psalm 84. Psalm 84 is a beautiful, beautiful hymn of worship and pilgrimage. And it's a great word for us this morning, but I encourage you to mark Psalm 84 and continue to read it as we celebrate this new year and this new season of opportunities. Let us be in worship and on pilgrimage. Psalm 84 reads in this way. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar. Lord Almighty, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains cover it with pools. They go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion. Hear my prayer, Lord Almighty. Listen to me, God of Jacob. Look on your shield, O God. Look with favor on your anointed one. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. Lord Almighty, blessed is the one who trusts in you. This is the word of the Lord.
Kings indeed. Thank you guys. That was a wonderful, wonderful rendition of We Three Kings. So again, my name is Valina Hoy. I'm not Hunter. Hunter Johnston, who is our Director of Family and Children's Ministries, is on vacation today. So we were hoping for rest and renewal for her. And she asked me to be here with you guys today, especially with the young ones. So I'm excited to share with you a little bit about Psalm 84. So if you haven't already, please find Psalm 84 in your Bibles. It is an awesome psalm to read. There are some of the verses that are just amazing to memorize. So if you want to read it today, I really encourage you to do so. But I'm going to focus on something that Joel just read about pilgrimage. It says to set your hearts on pilgrimage. So I want to talk a little bit about what pilgrimage is. Pilgrimage means a journey to a place that's important to your faith. So many people take a pilgrimage to the Holy Land, to be where the place is that Jesus walked, where he taught, where he did miracles, where they go to Jerusalem. He died outside of the city of Jerusalem on a cross and then was laid in a tomb and was resurrected on the third day. So people want to go to those places where he was. And instead of calling it a vacation, because it's not really a vacation, you're actually going to a place that's good for your heart and also a place where you want to meet God in a new way. So that's what a pilgrimage is. When we're on a pilgrimage, there are kind of three things that you do. First, you travel, and when you're traveling, you're kind of preparing your heart for what you're going to experience. And then when you get there, you're still and you're quiet, and so instead of talking to God, you listen and you look and you see how he might be moving in the world. And then when you leave the place and go back home, you start to reflect and you're grateful for the experience you had and the new ideas and the new faith that you've come to know. So I love to go on pilgrimages, but as you know, in the pandemic, we have not been able to travel very much. And so this also happened in the Middle Ages. And so they created something called labyrinth. And so if you guys could put that up on the screen so everyone could see. So this is a labyrinth, and they're built outside of cathedrals or right in on the stone of the court of a cathedral floor. And you see that there's just one entrance and you walk through the labyrinth like you're going on a pilgrimage. So you're preparing to encounter the living God. And so you walk through, it's not a maze, but because a maze has an exit. There's one way in and one way out. So you walk this journey, this pilgrimage, and as you're seeking the Lord. So as you're going in, you might be thinking about all the things you're leaving behind or things that might be on your mind and trying to prepare to be with the Lord. And then when you get to that very center where the flower is, when you get to that very center, that's the place to be still and to stop talking, but to listen for the Lord's presence and to see Him and to reflect on His word. And then after you've been there a while, you start your journey back out. And I've been on several of these pilgrimages on Labyrinth. There's actually one in the front yard of Norfolk General Hospital. And also at Lee Sentara Lee Hospital. So if you're ever there or walking around there, there are Labyrinths there that you can take that journey on. And it's just a wonderful opportunity to set your heart on a pilgrimage and to seek the Lord while He may be found. Another way you can use a labyrinth, I actually have a finger labyrinth that I have in my office. And so sometimes when I'm in my office, I can't even go outside or even go down the street to Norfolk General to find that labyrinth. And so I as I'm praying, my finger walks the labyrinth, and I do that same exercise of talking to God and kind of letting things go. And then when I get to the center, I'm still and I listen for the Lord. And then as I go out, I celebrate what He has shown me. So I hope that you'll go on a pilgrimage too. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank You and praise You for this day, for the opportunity, Lord, to set our hearts on pilgrimage. And we pray, Lord, that we would seek You while You may be found and call on Your name and listen to what You would have us to say and to do and to be. We thank You for Your love and grace. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And thank you, Valina. Well, good morning, everybody, and Happy New Year. It is 2021. I am especially grateful today for the opportunity to preach for you. Thank you to Pastor Jim and Pastor Valina. As I enter the final semester of my seminary journey, I am truly, truly grateful for all of the love and the support and nurturing care that you all have provided for me and Amy and Marissa in the season. It has truly been impactful and amazing, and for that I am eternally grateful to all of you. Would you pray with me? Gracious Lord, I ask that You open our eyes this morning to see and open our ears to hear Your word. Lord, soften our hearts. Speak through us and to us this morning, Lord. I ask especially today that You give our hands and our feet something great to do, something impactful for Your kingdom and a mighty work to be done. Lord, be present with us in this space as we dive into Your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. The text before us this morning, Psalm 84, I believe has the power to truly shape our lives in a meaningful way. When you think about it, the job of a doorkeeper is not a very glamorous one. Doorkeepers, it's not a highly sought-after position. It's often the lowest pay in an organization. It often has the most minimal responsibility. Doorkeepers genuinely sit, they monitor the door, they welcome visitors, they receive some mail, and they simply are required to be present. It's a basic duty, but I believe it's one that is the most important in an organization. If you think about it, the doorkeeper is the first face that a visitor sees when they arrive at a building. The doorkeeper is often the first person in the morning to greet somebody. Doorkeepers are the ones that recognize when somebody is having a bad day or if something is off. The psalmist in Psalm 84 declares boldly in verse 10 that his desire is to be a doorkeeper, the lowliest of positions, to be a doorkeeper in the house of my God. He rejects the earthly measure of living the good life. He puts off a life of decadence and a life of opulence in the tents of the wicked, declaring his desire to be a doorkeeper. So on the surface, it may seem that the psalmist is simply saying, any job in the house of the Lord is better than nothing. When I was growing up, we had a number of these sayings, and I'm sure you all have some similar ones as well, these little words of wisdom that get repeated over and over again, and they sort of shape us as we grow. When I first read this psalm, the very first thing I thought was this phrase that we used to say, and my uncles used to repeat all the time, dress for the job you want, not the job you have. Or I also remember my mother telling me when I was very young, she would always say to me, I don't care if you grow up to be a garbage man. Just be the best garbage man that the boss has ever seen. Right? The idea being that if you do your job well, you'll get noticed. If you do your job well, no matter how low you are on the company ladder, if you do your job well, you'll begin to climb and you'll begin to be promoted and recognized. These are values that we have in an earthly sense, but I don't think that's the case in the psalmist's declaration this morning. I don't think the psalmist is looking at it as an entry-level position and a ladder to be climbed. As I reflect on this, a doorway is a truly unique and special place. A doorway is the narrowest point between two spaces, often between the inside and the outside. The psalmist recognizes that doorkeepers in the house of the Lord stand at that point where the kingdom of heaven meets earth. The narrowest point, the doorkeeper stands to welcome, to invite in, to greet the weary and the heavy laden. The doorkeeper stands in this place because that is where the power and the presence of Jesus is. There's a man by the name of André Bessette. He was made a saint in the Catholic Church in 2010, and he was known simply to his parishioners as Brother André. But to historians, he's known as God's doorkeeper. Brother André was born in 1845. He was the eighth of 12 children. He was born to a humble family. His father was a lumberman in Quebec, Canada. As a young man, his devotion and his generosity were noticed by the pastor in his church, and he was recommended for service in the Congregation of the Holy Cross in Montreal. He was initially rejected due to his frail health, but his pastor continued to petition for him, and eventually he was accepted, and being a novice and being uneducated, he was given the position of a porter. Now, the porter is, in this setting, is essentially a doorkeeper. The porter is given quarters by the front door to the church, and their whole office, their duty, is to remain at the front door and to serve as an interaction point between the inside church community and the outside world. In this position, Brother André would often be invited into the homes of the sick to anoint them and to pray for them. Word quickly began to spread about these miraculous healings that would happen when Brother André would come to visit and anoint and pray. After a time, a small epidemic broke out at a local college, and the word of André's healing spread, and they started to bring people to the door of the church. A trickle at first, but it became so many people that they had to move André's office to the local train station in order to accommodate all the people that were coming to visit André. It's remarkable, not one person died in that epidemic, but what is truly remarkable, what really is interesting about Brother André is years later he was interviewed, and this attitude that comes through in his position in life as the lowly porter, the lowly doorkeeper, André simply said this. He said, when I joined this community, the superior showed me the door, and I remained there 40 years. I found the door, and I remained there. You see, André put all of the measure of earthly success aside to simply stand at the door. André found himself at the narrowest point between two spaces, and he stood there, and he stayed there. You see, passing quickly through a door, you may encounter somebody. But a doorkeeper requires intentionality. A doorkeeper is positioned to stand and to wait at the door. That way they're in a position to encounter the presence of another. When we encounter the presence of Jesus in our lives, I believe it's at a doorway. The very presence of Christ itself is a narrow space where the kingdom of heaven touches earth. Like the woman at the well, or the blind man who was healed at the pools of Bethesda, when we encounter this presence of God, we find ourselves on the threshold of the kingdom of heaven. We have opportunities daily to stand at this threshold and to experience the eternal weight of God's glory. My friends, are there doorways that you intentionally avoid in your life? Doorways we avoid because it's easier not to go there. A friendship that is challenging, a relationship that it's just easier not to. Perhaps there's a problem that you look and you say, that problem is just too big to solve. I don't know what to do. It's bigger than anything I can provide. Do you ever find yourself saying about a person that you know is struggling, a person you know is in the middle of something, and you simply say, I just don't know what to do or to say? The good news, the power of the gospel is this, that we simply need to position ourselves in that situation, to stand at that doorway, to invite and to welcome the power and the presence of Jesus. You see, Jesus meets us at the door because Jesus is the door. The gospel writer says, Jesus says in the gospel, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. As you all know, we've been hosting NEST, the Norfolk Emergency Shelter Team, for several weeks. And we will continue to do so until March 24th. And it's been a truly amazing season for us to be a host, not only to the 45 guests that sleep in this room each night, but also to host other faith organizations and churches and community organizations in this space. Each night as we prepare to open up, there's literally a doorkeeper. There's a volunteer that's assigned the position of doorkeeper. They stand outside, they organize the line, they welcome, and they invite each guest in to be checked in and to have their temperature checked and those things. For each of the 45 guests that stay in this room, it's the doorkeeper that welcomes them. The doorkeeper asks about their day and engages them in conversations about anything and everything from sports to guitars to what's for dinner to that night. There's a literal doorkeeper. But in this season, there are doorkeepers for the Lord. There's those people that stand at the threshold. There's people like Kelsey and Jay who have an adorable little one-year-old. They have day jobs. They have other responsibilities. And they've been here almost every week, at least four mornings a week before the sun is up to lead the checkout team. They've rearranged their lives so that one of them can stay home with Josie while the other comes in, and then go home and then trade off, and the other comes in to clean. Many of you here today, so many of you here today this morning have shown up to serve multiple times. Many of you have been committed to be in prayer for the guests and the volunteers. So many of you have donated financially to support, have donated material that is much needed for such an extended effort. You've donated desserts and food and clothing and just this outpouring of support and love and compassion. And truly, in this season of NEST, for our church, for this community, and the partners that engage with us, it's truly been a place where the glory of the eternal shines bright in this narrowest of spaces. It's full of doorkeepers that testify to the presence of Christ in each encounter that we have with one another. Several weeks ago on a Saturday morning, Nicole and Michael Del Favero were volunteering on the cleanup crew at Nest. As they left, they stopped to check on a woman who was sleeping right outside the door. The night crew had given her a meal and had given her some blankets to keep warm. You see, she arrived late in the evening after the shelter was full and we were at capacity. They did everything they could to make her comfortable, to care for her within the boundaries of what they were able to do. Several folks from the shift that evening had begun to reach out to other organizations, to make phone calls to anybody and everybody they could to try and find help for this woman. You see, as Nicole puts it, it was very clear that this woman had fallen on hard times, that this woman needed more than what we could provide. Throughout the night and into the morning, several people had checked on her and reassured her that the team was reaching out to do all that they could to find services for her. So later that morning, as the cleanup crew finished their work and Michael and Nicole left that morning, they stopped one last time to check on this woman. As they stopped this final time, the woman motioned for Nicole to come closer, and she let her know that she really needed help. She needed a change of clothes. She needed somebody to care for her. So not knowing what to do, they brought her in. They helped her get clean clothes and cleaned up, and they sat and they stayed with her that morning. See, it was a Saturday morning, and the soup kitchen starts at noon, and so that team arrives. And so they sat with her throughout the morning until the soup kitchen team got there to make sure that there was somebody to care for her. Because of all of this outpouring, the story has a happy ending. The woman was placed with a permanent shelter situation. She's now receiving the services that she needs and a level of care that is more appropriate for what she requires. And it's all because of the love and care, and it's all because those people who stepped into the narrow space where heaven touches earth and cared for this woman. And it's truly striking. Nicole reflected on the experience in an email, and she said this. She said, "As Michael and I walked out to our car, he said something to me that really resonated with me. And it was so simple, too. He said, 'I'm so glad we stopped to say something to her.' He was right. Just acknowledging her and seeing her as a human being made all the difference in the situation. I can't stop thinking about how often we all walk by people in need from fear of engaging or other feelings that hold us back. On Saturday morning, I believe God moved through us to help this woman that needed something as simple as a helping hand and a change of clothes. Knowing that her story ended with hotel housing and a reopened case with APS made me think that the Lord put her in our path for a reason. And I am so glad Michael and I had a small part to play in her journey to safer and hopefully better life. Her story is such an important reminder that what we as a church do in the city is truly making a difference. The Lord is present with us and working through us to touch the lives of others. And for that, we are so very blessed." Nicole said, "The Lord put her in our path for a reason. The Lord was present at the physical threshold of the building that morning as these three people were brought together. That encounter at the physical doorway became a door where the space between heaven and earth were so thin that the eternal glory of God shined through so brightly. As the psalmist says, 'How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere.' I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God." You see, the doorway is the narrowest point between two spaces. And if our eyes are open, we are surrounded by doorways. We are surrounded by points where the kingdom of heaven meets earth. We are called to stand in the doorway, to invite, to welcome, to reach out to all those who come, who are weary, who are heavy laden, people who are walking out of the pain and the sorrow of yesterday, people who are facing the uncertainty of tomorrow. Think about those people and those places in your life where it's simply easier to avoid. It's simply easier to walk through the door and go to the car. It's simply easier not to. It's too big. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. You can choose to pass by, or you can stop in the doorway. You see, the truth is this. When you stand in the doorway, you're not alone in that situation. The very power and the very presence of Christ shines through so brightly. You don't need the words to say. You don't need the solution. You just need to be present. Stand in the doorway and enter the eternal presence of our Lord Jesus. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, Father, we thank you and we praise you and we love you. We thank you for the doorways, the places, the thin and narrow points where the kingdom of heaven touches earth so closely that we can feel the eternal rush of glory like the air conditioning rushing out of an open door in the summer. Lord, I pray that you point us to those doorways, those places where your presence is, where we can be a doorkeeper on this side of heaven, Lord. Father, I praise you. I thank you. I pray that you be with us, that you illuminate those places in our lives, Lord. Because we know that if we simply stand in our presence, that you are there with us. And we are thankful for that. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. So as we continue to reflect on God's beautifully proclaimed word this morning, I want to remind you about our connection cards. If you're online, the link to the connection card is right above the live feed. We want to know that you're present here with us today. Fill that out. Let us know of any prayer concerns or praises that you might have. If you check confidential only, Jim Wood and I will see those particular prayer requests. But otherwise, our elders and deacons and prayer ministers will pray over those prayer requests. And so if you're here in First Hall, please fill out that connection envelope and put your tithe and offering inside and let us know about your prayers as well, and just leave it on the seat, and our greet and seat team will pick that up later. As we move into a time of prayer, I'm going to ask Joel to give you a quick update on what's going on with Nest this week.
Sure. So as I said, Nest is continuing till March 24th. It truly is a blessing. We've been hosting 45 people each night in this room, but we've also hosted other churches. We just wrapped up a week with Larchmont United Methodist and Christ the King. And it is amazing the power of the witness that we are to the guests, but also to others. So I encourage you to go to the website, fpcnorfolk.org. There are shifts available all the way out through March. There's opportunities to support material-wise, desserts, clothing, those things. So check the website and reach out. And it is it's overwhelming to me to look out and see so many people that have put in so much heart and compassion and have chosen to stand at the door where the kingdom of heaven is touching earth. So please continue. I encourage you to continue to reach out and to plug in.
Thanks. Awesome. Where the kingdom of heaven touches earth, we are so very grateful for our Nest ministry. We're also grateful for our connection with Kenya through Tree of Lives, and pray for the beautiful children that are assisted through our Joy Village and the Holy Family Center and the Alamano School. Just prayers of blessings for them and for their mamas and their families. And also, as we continue to pray, we want to lift up those who are suffering from COVID. Prayers for safety for health workers and first responders, and also success for the vaccine. Closer to home, we want to lift up Cordelia Baldwin. Cordelia is in the hospital. Her condition is serious, so prayers for her. Also for Kristen Lentz, who is on hospice now. We also want to lift up the Thornburg family, Henry and Chrissy. Chrissy's mother died right before Christmas, so prayers for their family. We also have a new baby to celebrate. Catherine Ann Gresham was born on December the 20th to Rebecca and Tom, so we celebrate with the Gresham family. We've also received prayer requests through our connection cards, 138 prayers for family and friends, for health issues and healing, for guidance, direction, and clarity, for peace, for reconciliation, and 10 praise reports, which we're always glad to receive. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you and praise you for the gift of this day. We thank you that you call us to be doorkeepers in your house. And so we pray that we would be in places, in thresholds where heaven meets earth. And Lord, we thank you that you are there with us, that you are the actual door. We just get to help facilitate your kingdom and your glory. And we're so grateful. We also thank you, Lord, for the privilege of praying for those who are burdened, and also for those who are rejoicing. And we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would continue to guide and lead us and bring unity and wholeness to this world. Hear our hearts, Lord, as I lift up the Lord's Prayer to you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I've never seen another one more beautiful than you. Than you. I have never seen another more beautiful. I have never seen another more lovely. I have never seen another more righteous. I have never seen, I've never seen another more beautiful. Never seen another more lovely. Never seen another more righteous. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord, for your love. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands, washed me. The Lamb, you are worthy. cross.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid.
Not a glamorous job, doesn't pay well, but I would much rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. I pray today that you find those thin spaces where the kingdom of heaven touches earth. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Higher lifted
Oh, God is good, and it has been good to be together today. I encourage you, if you want to stay and help the team to set up for Nest, you're welcome to do that. We also have coffee and sparkling grape juice to celebrate the new year and some goodies out there, so please stay and fellowship outside as well. Blessings to you.